All right, so without much ado, I think this session is all about, you know, trying to elicit answers to questions that nobody answers, get to the, you know, next level of detail on how e-commerce should be done. With that, I'll go to, I'll sort of start this session. The way we'll run it is that we'll spend about 40, 50 minutes initially just trying to question the panelists, and then we'll reserve the 30, 40 minutes towards the latter end for questions from the audience. And feel free to sort of, you know, ask all the questions that bug you in the nights. So with that, let me go to the first question to Vijay. Vijay, why don't you tell us what are some of the, just go back in time, you know, as you were sort of launching InfiBeam, in the early days, early couple of quarters, what were the things that were going in your mind? What challenges did you face? Some trade-offs in terms of hiring, technology, et cetera, that you had to make?
Hello.
Okay. I'm Vijay, just a brief introduction. So I run technology for InfiBeam. And prior to InfiBeam, I worked with Amazon in Seattle. And then I was also part of the starting co-founding team that built up the Amazon Dev Center in Bangalore. So in 2007, when we started, the thing was, yeah, obviously, we need to get out early, right? We want to be there as early as possible and then try to evolve. Now, there's always a big question that comes up. How good your technology should be. Should you build a prototype and go out? Or you build a big technology and build it for 2 years and then go out? So then we said, okay, let's just make this conscious call. Let's build the architecture right. And then so that if needed, we could always grow it out. But make sure that it's right so that if you do get hit to the bottleneck and you don't know, and if you have to go rewrite the whole thing out, it's going to be a very, very tough task. I think all the techies here would agree with me that we put a hack, we never fix it. It's a fact, right? Most of us live with that fact. So given that thing, the whole thing was, how do you architecture the whole thing out, but not necessarily go and build it out completely? So that was one of the things that we made, because the primary thing is, yeah, how do you go reach the customer first? We had a deadline up front. Now, the second choice was, where do you start? Right? Now, you could go to, I was in Bangalore, so we could have come to Bangalore. But we actually chose a tier two city. We chose Ahmedabad. Now, yeah, obviously, we wouldn't get the same number of resources. But trust me, every city has quality. That's true. Now, if you are a great company, you're going to attract the local talent. And every city has really good quality. Now, today, we are like the company in Ahmedabad. There's no number two today.
So that's interesting. I think the point, Vijay, you're making is that, look, reach out to the customer, get the architecture right. It's not important to have the 100% thing out there.
Yeah.
With that, let me go to Rajesh. You know, Rajesh, you at CBazaar must have had something similar in terms of experience. As you set out the goalpost as to when you wanted to launch, how should one entrepreneur, you know, all the young entrepreneurs should think about? Is it 3 months to launch? Is it 6 months to launch? How should they think about hiring? Is hiring more important or getting the product more important? You know, getting the product right is more important? Some views from you.
Yeah, hi. I'm the co-founder of CBazaar.com, and we had launched ourselves in 2005. In fact, I've been in e-commerce space from 1998 when we started ChennaiBazaar.com. So our story started like this. You know, we were pretty much a bootstrap company, and we had to develop everything in-house, the technology, the website, the back end, and the logistics and everything. So for any entrepreneur who is looking to start his venture, the key thing would be the proposition. What proposition he's going to offer to the customer. And if that proposition is very clear, and based on that proposition, he should plan out the execution. Like, for example, as Vijay mentioned, he chose Ahmedabad. But sometimes you need to really look at how soon can you reach, which will be the right location from where you could reach to the consumer, to the customer. Now, coming to, this is always a challenge, whether you build your back end strong or whether you build your front end strong. I mean to say, it should be like a case where you have to make sure there is a, you strike a balance between your marketing capabilities, I mean, the number of customers whom you go to target, the back end, your capabilities in terms of delivery. Like, it shouldn't be a case where you have too many orders and you don't have the capacity to deliver that. And the third thing is basically you should have enough products on the website so that you could also ensure that your growth target is always met. So these three things are very key for any business to start. And I think it's the product is the key thing. You know, if you have a great product offering on the website, that's if you fix that right, and then eventually you can fix your back end and front end eventually.
So I think Rajesh, just probing there a little bit more. Imagine if I was starting a business from scratch. The first question would come to my mind is that if I'm running an e-commerce operation, what size should be my warehouse? How big my logistic operation should be? How did you guys decide some of those issues? Should I plan for 6 months? Should I plan for 18 months?
I think, in our perspective, we plan for a year. But every time we plan for a year or we plan for 3 years. But we ended up moving places after 6 months. I mean, within 6 months, we realized that, okay, this planning is not right. And you got to take a bigger warehouse. You got to take a bigger capacity. But you should always plan for a larger, time period. I think 6 months, 9 months will be short. I mean, you have to plan for at least a year and above. That's what I would recommend to entrepreneurs.
Probably what he's meaning is plan as much as it takes to get the VC funding.
Yeah.
With that, I'll come to Shailendra. Nice segue. So, Shailendra, what advice you would have for some of the entrepreneurs as to things that one should not trade off? There can always be a company which can try to buy revenues through coupons, through couponing or discounting. In some cases, sort of almost ignoring customer service as well. Now, what are some of the trade-offs that you will recommend making and some that you will not recommend making?
Yeah, this is a tough question because as a young company, you want to show lots of transactions. You want to show that you're making progress. And there are some available shortcuts, i.e. couponing that Akash mentioned that we see being used a lot. Also other shortcuts, discounting, heavily discounting. And that will get you your early traction. This is not an easy decision that one can be prescriptive about. So I think you have to, what we have found works well is that you have a clear philosophy. We see both ends of the market work. For some people, discounting does work, and it does get them to a lot of scale. And for other people, staying fixed price, staying premium, even charging for delivery, right from upfront works. The one thing is the decisions you make early are more important than you might think, because they set the tone for your customers. Your most loyal customers will come to you in the first few months. They'll find you, and you won't so much as find them. And they will be the ones who will tweet about you. They'll be the ones who will, refer people to you. And, their perception of your value proposition is quite important. So what you stand for, if you change it soon after, if you change it downstream, then you confuse your consumer. And for this reason, it may seem like a trivial thing. One could say, hey, I can do couponing 1 month and not another month. But you're training your consumer to wait for the coupon. If you start doing couponing, and they will always wait for the coupon, and it's very tough to go away from it. So it's these early decisions can matter a lot. I think I don't have a right or wrong answer. I think it depends on the category and how you're trying to build your business. But the one thing that is important is to have a consistent and clear thought process from the get-go in your early days.
Thanks. With that, let me come to Sachin. Sachin, at Paytm, I think it's a relatively different e-commerce company. It's more virtual goods rather than, having to have a warehouse or logistics operation. So what are some, in your business context, what are the challenges that you saw and how did you tackle them?
Rather than saying them as challenges, I would say that what are the opportunities we see? We are into online recharge business. We provide recharges for mobile, DTH and data cards. There are a few other players in the industry. We just started a few months back. And the challenge was, where do we position ourselves? And what's the differentiator that we want to create? And I think that the only one thing that we are focusing on to start with is customer service and customer delight. It starts right from the moment customer lands on our website, the whole interface, the whole look and feel, the whole user experience. Second thing is the delivery of the service, delivery of recharge. And third thing is, which is the most important along with all other, is how do you manage customers in case they face any issues. You do whatever amount of QA, as we talked of, you have to launch the product first. You launch the product, whatever amount of QA you will do, you would find 40% of X number of bugs going into the market. It's very important at this point to read and make sure that whatever each and every customer is saying, we as the core product team reach each and every customer feedback that we receive. And you know, that provides us a lot of insights that, you know, on an Hotmail account, the font of our email is too small, or on some browser, this thing is not visible, or in some web browser, this is not working. So, you know, each and everything that customer says is of the paramount importance, and that's where we learn what we need to improve from. And second thing is, people talk of social media. I think we are using social media primarily for customer service in Delight, and, you know, create customers and get referrals from there. We use Twitter and Facebook for all of our customer queries. So any query that come on Facebook and Twitter is answered within 2 minutes or maximum 10 minutes.
Understand.
So that's where we are focusing on, you know, the customer delight.
Understood. So I think the key message we are taking away from you is that, look, first of all, customer delight is probably the highest on your parameters. And second, you're using social web, social media with a very strong effect. You are able to leverage that very well.
Yes.
Now, I think related to that question is that whenever you focus too much on customer service, there is a direct, you know, impact on your operational expenditure as well in being able to take either calls unless you're using social media very effectively. So what are, you know, some of the trade-offs that you may have seen leading to, and I'll direct this question more to, you know, logistics-based e-commerce guys. What are the economic trade-offs that you've made in terms of customer service? Do you see that as important as Sachin sees it?
Definitely, yes. Basically, because we are in the fashion industry, and we have to make sure that you know, we answer to any customer queries at the shortest period of time. You know, and moreover, the industry where we are, people ask questions like, okay, will this product look good on me, or will this product, you know. So those kind of questions, again, I mean, but there is a lot of opportunity here, which we feel that, okay, people really want some kind of an, you know, someone to mentor them or someone to advise them, okay, this is good or this is bad. So customer service have to be on top of, I think any business, any e-commerce business, customer support has to be on top of everything. But for companies like us, yes, we spend quite a lot of, you know, our resources in ensuring that we have a fair and large customer support team. We are 24/7 on live chat. Also, we have toll-free call center numbers. And I mean, the best example I would quote in this is Zappos. I had a chance to visit Zappos in Vegas, and the guys, every single member in that company are amazingly enthusiastic about how they want to treat the customers. So I think customer support has to be the prime key.
Understood.
Thing.
No, that's very helpful. I think the point that you guys are making across the sort of board is that, look, customer service and delight is very important, though there is an attendant operational cost which comes with it. I think earlier in the day, Shailen was mentioning that, look, the economics on the gross margin basis for a Zappos type company might have been completely different from what it is in India. So probably there is a ceiling and a fine balance that one needs to play to be able to create a positive unit economic model while also not compromising on the customer service. Now,
one small thing which I have to add. So we had this policy when we started. Each one of us would sit as a customer service agent. Be it your BD, be it the CEO, including Vishal, who is the CEO. We sat there, because once you sit there, you're going to know the pains of the customer. And you make sure, in whatever you do, either be it you are in logistics, or you're a developer, be whatever it may be, you're going to know what the customer is going through. And when you hear what the customer says, you actually innovate on top, how to solve it. Now, when you actually make it a report, and it does solve problem, not saying no, but nothing like being there. Being there for a week, because either be it a Rakhi season or a Diwali season, I've been there, I've sat there. And sometimes you get abuses, I'm not saying no. But
talk about those.
But the thing is, we have seen it go down, because when you put the actual people who run the show in the tight spot,
right,
they learn. And not only is that, you actually, when you hear the complaints, you tend to say, okay, how can I solve this?
Sure.
Rather than seeing it as, okay, one of my top items is this. I've been there, what if I was a customer?
I think learn from the customer.
Yeah.
As much as you can.
Yeah.
And as early as you can.
Went and delivered, you know, a lot of our items to our customers. We were delivery boys for a few days, I mean, so that was another experience which we wanted to see, okay, how does the customer, you know, reacts when they receive a product. And I think every entrepreneur should, you know, sit, take every role in the organization, and they have to devote some time at every role so that they could learn, they could get a lot of inputs from that.
Sure. Thanks, Rajesh. Let me shift gears a little bit on technology, right? We have a, you know, very solid technology guy on panel. So why don't you tell us... yeah, Vikram, why don't you tell us what do you think from a startup's perspective, how important it is to have a fully fledged tech solution on day one versus, for example, the questions we keep getting asked is, look, do I need to have a fully fledged ERP solution, or can I just start with a, you know, tally, and then life goes by?
Right. So actually, you know, what you're talking about is two different things. One is a fully fledged technology solution that is reaching to the customer, which is your front end, your website, or your mobile device apps. The other is what do you do internally? How efficiently are you running your internal IT so that your employees are productive? And I think from a startup's perspective, the first one is probably more relevant and more important. But I think we, obviously customer experience is supreme. You know, the first time a customer lands on your site, if the experience is not good enough, he'll walk away and you'll not be able to convert it into a transaction. But we believe for an entrepreneur, the hitch is initially the first step to going live. And going live just doesn't mean your website or the front end. Because I think the amount of effort you'll put on building a website or building the front end will be so, so much less than the amount of effort that will be required of putting the back end together, right? Especially in e-commerce, you have to have your supply chain in place. You have to have your suppliers, your payments, your gateways, all that resolved before you go live or before you even think about, you know, revamping your website or looking at the customer experience. But I think the main topic here was scale. And a lot of customer experience also depends on the rate at which you're growing or the seasonality you see in your business, right? If you're offering items that are highly seasonal, you know, only sold during Diwali time or Akshaya Tritiya time or something like that, you should ensure that technology does not hinder the customer experience. And I think that today technology is advanced enough to be able to do that.
Understand. No, but I think, Vikram, the next level of detail on that is that, look, of course, everyone would not want to compromise their operation because of technology being the hindrance. That's an enabler to the business. But imagine a startup, which many of us are here today. The question they face is, with the amount of funding, the bootstrap, the time that they have, should they invest, you know, with a, you know, kind of 12-month view to technology or operation or with a 24-month?
I think that's an excellent question. And I think the question was more relevant maybe 3-4 years ago. Today with the advent of cloud, I think it becomes a moot point. Because really when you plan for technology like a year in advance, what you're really planning for is how many servers I need to buy, how many software licenses I need to buy, how many technical people I should have so my site is always up and running and all that. The cloud takes it away, right? So we actually at this point in time, we are at a stage where you just go live with one small instance, one small server running the entire application because you know that you can scale it up very easily, very fast. It's elastic, right? That's what the cloud makes it.
Interesting. And you know who's the guy to go to when it comes to buying a solution like that. So with that, let me ask Jitendra. You know, at Marjack, you've seen many, many interesting startups come to you for leveraging your platform and get a quick launch. What would be your recommendations for some early startups to sort of manage the speed of the launch with the quality of the launch? Not just go ahead and, you know, be out there, but be able to do that with all the constraints that we're talking about in terms of maintaining customer service and everything.
So I will just visit back to the earlier question which you asked, Vikram. The technology where you are doing a trade-off. See, the investment when you are doing a bootstrap and you have a certain amount of money only to spend. Whether you are an e-commerce company, finally you are into e-tail. So you are into e-tailing. So focus on your supply chain, getting the product ready, getting the customer service in place. Let technology be taken care by the experts. You can plan, you can say that it is a SaaS platform. So whether a technology should be an operating expenses or a capital expenses. So if you take it as the operating expenses, of course it is not going to be very heavy. If you're taking a 9 months, 12 months time to develop a technology, it becomes a capital expenses. Rather than you can choose a SaaS platform, which will be easier and it will be a monthly fees. So we always suggest any new startups or even the retailers. We serve a lot of retailers who wants to go online now. So we always tell them that technology is not your forte. So you are into e-tail, get the things right. Whatever the business require for retailing is also required for e-tailing. There is nothing different. The same customer is buying online. Only thing is, it's a technology enabled channel which he is buying through. So use that. Use sensibly the money which you have. Don't overspend. And make sure that all the ingredients to make a customer delight happening is happened through that.
Understand. Now, I think one part that we have not yet touched is the mobile, you know, segment of the internet. And with that, I'll come to Manish. You know, Manish, you lead TextWeb. So can you tell us a little bit about TextWeb itself, and then tell us how important do you feel is mobile as a theme to e-commerce? And then we can come to some of the entrepreneurs who have done this on the internet and are now, you know, maybe looking to do it on mobile. So
sure. So just to quickly tell you a background about us, we are part of Intuit, which is a US-based $4 billion revenue company. And we have launched TextWeb around 1 year ago in India. And it's basically a mobile SMS-based app platform, right? So when we are talking about mobile, I think most of us must be thinking that it must be an application-driven business that we might be talking about, because it always helps, because when we're talking about multimedia rich application, it helps e-commerce companies a lot. But you know what we have realized, and we never, I mean, you know, none of us thought that SMS could be also an angle to e-commerce. So we got back to our platform, we saw the searches that happens on platform, and we saw that close to 80% of the searches on our platform, which is out of the 20 to 30 million messages every month, most of the messages happens for booking online tickets, booking you know, some sort of a food restaurant, some sort of electronics that they want to buy. So they quickly wanted to check the price of a mobile phone, right? So I am, for example, I am a user and I am going around in the shopping mall, and I quickly wanted to search the price of the latest LG 32-inch TV. Now, I don't have access to internet on mobile, right? There are hardly few people who have access to internet on mobile, and it's a very intermittent access even when you are at home. So what will you do, right? I mean, we are roaming around in the markets and we wanted to know the price of a product quickly. Now, as an SMS, because we are a pull-based service, so you just send your product that you want to know the price of, and you get the price which is the cheapest price available out of all the e-commerce companies available. So you know that where to go to buy that product, right? I mean, what we're saying is that you're helping a customer to stay connected with you 24/7, as compared to when a user is out in the mall and when he wants to make a buying decision, he comes back home by the time he has forgotten about your product. But if you are already mobile enabled, so the idea is the person has to be, the product per se has to be, should help cost saving, should help convenience to a user, and should help choice to a user. So these three things matters a lot when we're talking about technology per se and when mobile comes into picture.
Very interesting. So with that, let me ask Sachin, do you have a mobile strategy? How do you think, you know, mobile is going to come into play with your business model?
Yeah, I think we already have a mobile strategy, and we are actually already executed to some extent. We are not talking about it a lot yet, but since the launch, I think just 1 month after the launch, we have the website ready, which works on paytm.com, and you can open from any mobile, and it will give you an interface which is customized as per your mobile device. We also have an app thing going on. We have apps already ready for mobile recharge for iPhone, BlackBerry, Android, and Java-based.
Very interesting.
So I think the only challenge is that we are not focusing app as a content provider. We are focusing on app and mobile as well as a transaction channel for us. And you know, with the challenges related to OTP and awareness of customer with respect to OTP, we are seeing less traffic. But I think eventually it is growing up. Now there are more technologies available. A few weeks back, we launched a WAP application in which on high-end phones like iPhone, BlackBerry, or Nokia phones, you can actually pay by 3D secure and not using OTP. So, you know, we have seen a great spurt there, and the same would be then launched on the apps as well. So definitely, I think mobile is an integral part of the strategy. And
interesting, but I meant more from the young starting up entrepreneur's perspective. If one was to trade off, should they also bring the mobile, you know, animal out, or should they just focus on the web? You know, maybe Vijay, what's your perspective?
See, the thing in India is mobile has more reach. It's a fact. Now, I don't know the actual percentage of smartphones or what it is, but it need not be full-fledged, but if you can think of something innovative, if you believe you have something different as an idea, and it can reach people, it'll give you identity. Identity might will drive transactions in the future, maybe not today, but it'll ring a bell when somebody hears the name. So, but, basically all I'm saying is, if you have a good idea, I wouldn't mind going after it, but always weigh your costs. Because your core product, if it's going to be for online customers,
right,
that could, it doesn't need just to be a transaction platform on mobile, or somebody has to make a transaction, or somebody has to do something. It could just be even for an identity.
Got it. So defensive, but watch your costs. Yeah. Now, on the topic of costs, I think there were several metrics that Shailendra put up, you know, in the morning, around average sale price, cost of customer acquisition, etc. Just wanted to spend some time with the group on what are the learnings, you know, here on actually driving each of these metrics to where they should be. So maybe cost of customer acquisition, taking that one just as an example, I think it's one of the major cost chunks in the operational expenses of any e-commerce company. So maybe starting with Shailendra, you know, Shailendra, have you seen some portfolio companies do anything innovative to reduce the CAC down innovatively?
Yeah, I think customer acquisition cost has two pieces. One, you know, how much you pay to acquire them. Two, you know, how they behave in the future. So what we find very useful is that is for each company to do a cohort analysis and keep doing a cohort analysis month on month. And in fact, every one of our companies does that. So the customers you acquire in Jan, in Feb, in March, in April, and so on, we typically use time-based cohorts, and we track their behavior in future time periods. And so as you will, each of you will naturally do, in your customer acquisition, you'll use different campaigns, you'll do viral, you'll do coupon some months, you'll try many different things to see what works best. And in order to distill the right learnings, you need to be able to say, okay, in Jan or Feb, I will use X kind of strategy over other strategies, and this will be the predominant type of cohort I will try to build. So early on, you have to make these experiments and create specific cohorts that you can then track. What we found, as a summary, I was just explaining how companies will typically do it. Again, as you talk to investors, you will realize they will always ask you for cohort-based economics, because that's what really tells you a customer you acquired a few months ago, you know, what's its true value. And, you know, you'll plot it on a curve, and you will try to then plot many more such curves and see whether they seem to make sense or not. But in summary, what we found is that virally acquired customers are far more valuable, no surprise. And so every time you can get somebody to refer a person and they come and transact, even if there's an incentive involved, such customers are far more valuable than just direct marketing on the web. So, you know, organic traffic, viral traffic is far more valuable than paid traffic, essentially.
Interesting. So, you know, Sachin, you were mentioning interesting things that you've done on the web, on the social, to probably also acquire customers. Now, can you give us some next level of insight? Are you driving Facebook 5 rupee per like kind of traffic, or how does social play? How much Google, how much Facebook? Some very tactical tips for us.
We are not spending any money on social to get customers. Social is a medium that, you know, is growing organically, and we are totally focusing on it as an organic medium. We're spending money on a lot of other things, and, you know, to reach out new customers, because the objective for Paytm is to, you know, bring customers on board and let them try it. And that's where we see, you know, that let them come and try it. We are sure that the product would make the service that we are offering is a need. You know, a lot of e-commerce companies are playing on impulse buying. You know, you offer something which is a good deal or good thing, and person wants to buy it. What we are offering is a need. He needs to recharge his mobile after every 20 days. He needs to recharge his DTH after every 30 days. So it's about positioning your product that, you know, he needs it, and we would make sure that his needs are satisfied with most convenience to him.
Very interesting. So I think lots of learnings. With that, we'll take a quick pause here. Lots of interesting learnings from varying as widely to how much you should spend on technology versus to how you can drive your customer acquisition costs to a certain level. I think I would not come in the way of opening the floor to questions, and feel free to ask questions to the panel here. Like I said, be as open as you can. You guys can raise your hands and we can pick.
So the question I'm facing these days is if you can give some insights about for a new startup, new venture, inventory management for something like Flipkart, if someone is going to emulate that model, inventory management, just-in-time inventory management seems too difficult and frustrating to start with, but at the same time, being an online store doesn't have a visibility on the street like a physical store. So filling, buying a lot of inventory and keeping it in a warehouse doesn't seem to be that good an idea to begin with. But just-in-time inventory model seems very difficult following it, because it's very frustrating getting a single piece when you get an order and then you know, shipping it to the customer. So how do you strike a balance between the
I think core? The question is, you know, how much cash and carry versus how much consignment? I think maybe, Vijay, you want to take a shot at it?
See, primarily for such a model, first of all, it should be highly analytics driven. It really helps you. Now, I'm not very sure how much it will help you on the first day, but it's very, very important part of deciding whether I'm going to go buy back-to-back or am I going to buy upfront. Now, you need a very good merchandiser. Who knows what to upsell? Because there's the problem with online is, or the issue that you might face are like, okay, the head is already taken by some other bigger site. You may not even rank in Google. Then you might come in for the long tail, which is another thing that Mr. Shahendra pointed out. Now, when it comes to long tail, inventory might not be available. So it's a complex thing, right? So it's nothing like one straight answer. It's an evolution. You study your customer behavior also, because maybe your customers come in only for the long tail, because the head is already going to some other destination. Now, then it's a matter of how do you convert the head to you. So on the first day, I would say the way we grew out was, okay, let's see, let's learn. We did stock up, but what was the real head? But then learn it as it grows, because a lot of things determine how transaction happens on your site. Right, apart from your basic customer experience, all the other things apart, there's this competition, which Mr. Chandra pointed out. So you might lose out all the customers to them. So it's an evolution. And I don't know if there's like a one single line.
Actually, technology can help you a lot, especially in terms of analytics. And of course, on the first day, you don't know. Analytics is something you learn as you do your business. I think the initial call is your gut feel, most probably. But within a couple of months now, you can actually extract enough intelligence out of your existing data to be able to take intelligent calls on how to optimize your inventory. So that's something you might want to explore.
One more thing. I want to ask this to Shailendra as well. Same question. I think how much proportion of inventory you carry within your warehouses leads to a lot of, you know, lockup of cash and has immediate bearing on you know, how much money do you raise or how much cash coffers do you need to have? So what's your advice to entrepreneurs here?
Yeah, Akash is cold calling me because we have spent many cycles trying to answer this question. Like you heard before, there are no easy answers. But consistently in India, what we find is that the supplier ecosystem is not evolved enough so that if they give you an inventory feed saying, I have 50 things in stock of a certain kind, then you go take an order, you will end up not finding 50 almost consistently. So in Fashion & You, for instance, where Akash and I are both involved with that investment, this is a constant pain where that business model world over works on zero inventory or little inventory, where you take an order and then you go purchase. The problem is your suppliers, when they say, you know, they have something, they don't really have it. Or they'll say, I have a blue shirt, but it'll turn out to be a green shirt. And then, you know, your customer is upset and that's a constant issue you have to sort of solve for. So it's very tough to do consignment. The customer experience will suffer. And either the customer has to be evolved enough that they understand that you are doing consignment. Like in Fashion News case, we are trying to educate the customer by separately saying these are express shipped items, so you'll get them quickly. These we hold in-house. And these are, you know, 2 to 3 week delivery items because, you know, we actually procure them later. In lieu of that, you get a great price. But it's not easy. The internet consumer yet is not evolved enough to be forgiving to you to allow for that time lag. So, unfortunately, inventory is a more capital-intensive model, but the leaders will be established on quality of customer service, on customer delight, on the viral effects of that reputation that you built.
So, you know, it looks like the market is headed towards more inventory and more in-house and is not headed towards consignment.
So just to add to that, I think as much as you can virtually lock up the inventory, that's the best. But there'll be a point where you can't virtually lock up anymore because of competition or whatever reason. Then you have to reduce all the things that Shailendra was mentioning, like short stock, bad stock, misstock, because these will all lead to customer dissatisfaction, and you don't want that.
So. Yeah, and the next level of evolution, what Akash meant was that, you know, keep inventory, but don't pay for it.
Yeah.
So you can tell your supplier, hey, I'm going to keep your inventory in my warehouse. When it sells, I'll pay you, and I'll manage you. And, you know, the step two is, like Amazon does in the US, further step beyond is to say, I'll ship it for you, too, on your e-commerce site as well. And I think you guys are trying to go there. So,
just to add to that, it's a new model with a lot of suppliers we are working with. It's coming out with a drop shipping model, where they want to have a lot of e-commerce sellers selling through their channel, and they are ready to do the supplies. So you sell and then back-to-back buy from them, and you get a ready-made inventory up to time, just in time, and you can buy that. So that model is now evolving in India. So you can try it out that also.
Very interesting.
It's called drop shipping, isn't it?
Yeah, it's called drop shipping model.
Shall we go to the next question? Okay, gentleman over there.
I think some of it has been answered, but I'll still ask it. I think what I wanted to ask is about customer experience. And some things that we've discussed in my team, at least, is that as companies are growing, their customer experience at the beginning...
Can you please tell the name of your company as well and your name?
My name is Amritash. I run a library service in Chennai. I don't think it's relevant to the conversation, but as companies grow, their customer experience is dropping quite significantly. Just Dial and I'll tell Flipkart's experience, because I can see from their Facebook page they've been inundated with complaints in the last at least a month or so. You just spoke of fashion and you. How do you deal with why does this happen? I mean, why do they start so well and then flash?
Very well put. So any volunteers for taking that question? Sure.
This is bound to happen. I mean, any company, I mean, because customers have different expectations at different point of time. I mean, when they order, they have different expectation, and when the order is in process, their expectation changes, and when the product is delivered, the expectation again changes. So you really cannot, It's always going to be challenging. I'm not saying that, you know, it cannot be solved, but again, it's going to be a challenging issue. For example, in our website, in CBazaar, we are selling our products worldwide. So it so happened that one of our customer, she logged in, and she was from India. But whatever happened is she saw the pricing in USD. I mean, though we have currency converter. And but we realized that she's a customer from India and she's ordering in USD. So our customer support immediately called her and said, okay, looks like you made a payment in a wrong currency. And when we tried to contact the customer was not available. She was traveling abroad in that part of time. That's why she ended up paying in USD because of the IP thing. But eventually when she got delivered, and then the product was all great, but then she was in India when the product got delivered. And then she placed a complaint to us saying that, why have you guys charged me in USD? Why have you not told me that I have to pay in INR? But as a company, we attempted that to solve that problem. I mean, we attempted reaching the customer. We have emailed the customer. But the customer, without even seeing that email, she just placed a complaint. So such kind of scenarios are bound to happen. And it's not that companies are not working towards it. I'm sure every company which is growing, these are all challenges which they have to face.
I'll actually answer that question a little differently. I'm not sure whether quality of service is suffering as much as the noise about it is. Because what's happening is more consumers are trying these services. The percentage of consumers who are dissatisfied is still the same perhaps, but now the absolute number is more, and it's the dissatisfied consumers who make the most noise and go and, you know, blog everywhere and, you know, write on Facebook pages and so on. So often, you know, this data is skewed, and the reason I'll make this argument is let's think about travel, and let's think about the OTAs, and you know, people here could disagree about which is the best one, and at least in terms of product and consumer delight and all that, but at least in terms of UI and consumer experience, I think ClearTrip ranks pretty high. And go to Mouthshut and see how many percentage of people recommend ClearTrip. You will be shocked that less than 20% of people recommend ClearTrip, and then you ask yourself why. And the answer is, I think this data is skewed that you are referring to online, perhaps. It is tough to scale customer experience at larger scale, but these companies are all struggling and they're trying to fix processes. I think some of the answer is, I'm not trying to take away that customer service has gotten worse, but I don't think it is as bad as it might seem through blogs and such.
Sorry, please go ahead. You had a question.
Related to that point, we use Net Promoter Score, NPS, where I was wondering if any of these companies use it, either the ones, because this is exactly to your point, just you can see the noise, but how do you measure on a consistent basis? Let me just explain maybe. Net Promoter Score is where you ask one question. They found that the best way to sum it all up is, would you recommend this to a friend, 1 to 10? 9 and 10 is promoters, 1 through 6 are detractors, 7, 8 neutral, and you just do promoters minus detractors. And you can actually compare it. You can do competitive comparisons, and you can look at, like, Zappos is like 70 or 80. That's really high. Some companies are negative because it can be negative. So just to your point, is that something that your portfolio company or any of you use, is that something in the India sort of system, the Net Promoter Score?
Yeah, absolutely. We're using Net Promoter Scores. I think the more evolved ones are getting there and certainly using metrics like that. Also, we'll have companies conduct surveys across their user basis and try to segment their users. So, what do their most loyal users say? Chances are their most loyal users are actually very satisfied. And Fashion New, for instance, has higher repeat buying than any other e-commerce company we have seen. It's up in the 60s. Which is shocking, right? You'd say, if you read the blogs, you'll say, hey, there are so many customer service problems, and why is 60% of all orders from repeat customers? So for a certain kind of customer that Fashion New appeals to, they're fine with the service. It's just that you are comparing that discounted product to a full-price product and the service you get with the full-price product. And that's why there is this sort of call it, mismatch of expectations almost. But to answer your question, we do use Net Promoter Scores. And in companies which have a lot of that noise, it's actually very valuable to know where you stand with your consumers.
And in fact, just to add one bit, I think in some of the companies, at least we are closely involved in some of these customer dissatisfaction metrics are monitored at the board level, which means that the company gives undue attention to trying to manage some of that.
Just to add to what others have also said, right? I mean, what we have seen in India, specifically the online companies, what they do is they do a lot of online service. So they depend on online customer feedbacks, right? And why Intuit as a company has been so popular and so big with our single product generating $1 billion revenue is because we have a core philosophy. Right from day one, from the scratch, we do follow me homes. That's the most popular term in the US. Now what we do is we actually go to the customer and speak to them and get their feedback. Then we incorporate the feedback back into the product. Because if we incorporate that, we are actually giving back to the customer what they're looking for as compared to just getting some online service and see if that makes sense for my business or not. So that could be one of the potential things that today's startup can also start exploring.
Right. So let's move to the next question then.
Yeah, I have a question. The question is regarding the cash on delivery.
Sorry, I can't see you.
Okay. Hi, I'm Ankur. I have a question on cash on delivery. Can you help me understand the economics of cash on delivery and how I should price it in my product?
Paid. Probably that's the question.
Yeah, I can take a shot at it. I think cash on delivery is a little bit of a necessary evil because people don't want to pay online. And they don't want to prepay. And we are educating the consumer to say, hey, you have an option. When the good shows up, you can return it. And so some of it is sort of our own doing because we are pushing the market a little bit in that direction. It's a convenience. It's a great service to have. And so people are adopting it. But they're also sometimes abusing it. What we have seen tactically as things you could do is two or three things. One, there are different options of cash and delivery available. There are new models like GharPay, et cetera, that are still early, and so you should talk to guys like that are trying to decouple the cash on delivery with the delivery of the goods themselves. So if you can collect the cash up front, the guy is more committed, and then you can deliver afterwards, so you'll have lower returns. Whenever there's prepayment, there are lower returns. The second thing we see companies doing is that they're calling you before shipping products on cash on delivery. So they're confirming an order just to, again, to make sure that they're only shipping it to people who really want it. What they find is that the time lag it takes after an order is placed to deliver and collect payment is directly proportional to the percentage of returns. So if you can deliver same day or next day, even on cash on delivery, you will have lower returns. Versus if you take 5 or 6 days, they've moved on. They, in a period of finding a great deal, they place an order. Now they're sort of disinterested, or they may not be home, all of those issues. The third is the cash on delivery vendors, also how you manage them is important. So some companies are building tools to manage and track these cash on delivery vendors. And what they're doing is they're using the APIs from these vendors to know where things are at, you know, the delivery and cash collection processes, and then proactively intervening to say, hey, the morning of the delivery itself, let's call them again. So, you know, they're trying to essentially have some, you know, process intervention and fixes to help avoid some of the common problems that cash and delivery faces. You know, the single biggest reason goods are returned in at least our portfolio companies is because the person isn't home or just not there. They're not reachable. And, you know, that's a tough one to solve for.
Correct. So just looking at the, let's go to the next question, gentlemen here.
So just a quick question. There are about 2.4 million e-commerce businesses in the US. I know that you've mentioned it's a winner-take-all model. There's about 1.4 million in China, and nearly 40% of them at the bottom end of the pyramid, you know, the ones that are doing less than 5 million are still profitable. So there is a winner-take-all model, but there is 400,000 in the US, there is more than 500,000 in China that are still doing profitable business, maybe doing the same products, maybe doing different products. So I want to make sure that I understand, maybe a few of you talking about, it is a winner-take-all model, but for a certain set of companies and a certain set of categories, and it's not one of those where none of these guys have an opportunity anymore, is the sense I think maybe a few of them might have gotten. So can you just talk a little bit about that?
This is a question for Shailendra, I guess, from his morning topic?
For
Infibeam? Okay.
Yeah, I think thank you for bringing that out. That was certainly not the intent to suggest that there would only be one or two successful companies. I think my intent was to say that, you know, to urge entrepreneurs not to do me too and to think different and to try to innovate with the model. You're totally right. There's a large number of small merchants in e-commerce. I think in the context of them raising institutional capital and them, you know, having the aspiration of building a big business, that number is a smaller number. And so a large number of SMEs, distributors, people who have shops, and others find this to be an additional and incremental channel, and often quite effectively so. The power sellers on an eBay and other places, you know, they have nice small businesses. But I think I was speaking more from the hat of, you know, those entrepreneurs who are seeking to, you know, build, to take institutional capital and have the aspiration to build a very large company.
So as Infibeam, we kind of believe that everybody can come online. And that's why we actually launched this product, Build a Bazaar. You can pretty much launch an e-commerce store in less than 5 minutes. A full-fledged store, fully working, payment gateway integrated with fulfillment panels, everything. Like what, 6 clicks of a button. That's pretty much what it takes. And the second advantage you get is you can sell virtual inventory of other products, which Infibeam handles. Now, we are putting our weight behind your supply chain and helping you deliver. So assume you want to launch in a particular category. Right? Now, you might want to extend yourself to go to another category. Now, instead of going and doing all the hard work, you can say, okay, let me try it with Infibeam's catalog. If it works well, let me just do it on my own. So we give you that flexibility because we believe commerce is very old in this country. People have a lot of innovative ways to do things. We are just an enabler to them.
So I guess the group is saying that, look, there is a lot of scope for many, many more companies to be built. Just don't do a me too. Try to innovate all the time on any
that
aspect.
Comes to the basic point Mr. Shailendra pointed out. We did this because, you know what, keep your eye on the cost.
Yep.
The technology which we give you, it's actually free to start. No payment upfront. You start, you run it. And we have seen more than a few thousand implementations since the last few months we launched. And every settlement, bi-weekly video settlement, we see 5x growth.
Amazing. So you know who to talk to as well.
But
yeah.
May I have the question, please?
Next question. Gentleman over at the back. Sorry. Yeah.
My question is, I'm Ravi and I'm an aspiring entrepreneur. So my question is, when one of you started your venture, could you give a generic idea of the cost background, cost breakdown? Like, for example, if I need a technology platform,
it will cost me to the tune of X, and if my revenue is Y, my cost for the inventory management will be Y% of that.
That's an as detailed question as it gets. So, any volunteers here?
That's an evil question. I would just suggest, go as my colleague pointed, like, use a SaaS model to start with if you can. Get your business out. You can get it out in like less than a day, potentially, with all your catalog and everything. Or if you really want to have your own model, I think you have to live through it.
I have a suggestion. Why don't you look at this, this SaaS model called Magento, this company called Magento, and they have a very good e-commerce product. So I think, the cost is not very high. And once you get into that, then probably you'll understand, okay, what is the cost involved and how does it bottoms down to your unit metrics.
I think the group is trying to variabilize the costs as much as possible, so that by not building too many fixed costs into the business, you don't infuse a lot of risk. Try to keep it as variable, as third party as possible in the beginning, and only insource those parts of the business which you see as extremely important to the running. Which is where, you know, to begin with, I think you can, one example was Magento, you know, we have Marjack as well. Then there is Build-A-Bazaar. All these are variants of shops that are available to lift and deploy in the market tomorrow. So you had some inputs as well?
Yeah. So to answer your question directly, you're asking for a cost breakup. I'm assuming that you're planning way out and you're not just talking about just starting up, because obviously starting up, the question has been answered. Typically, I think a successful business, I can talk about a technology cost, and this just doesn't apply to e-commerce. It applies to various other online businesses, applications, B2B and so on. Ideally, you should be somewhere in single digits percentage-wise of your total cost structure, of your variable cost, especially if you're going with cloud. If you see it running into double digits, then you know that there is something wrong and you need to optimize. And from a technology perspective, at least, I think that's a rule of thumb you should look at.
I have a question over here. I am Nalan. And my question is, what should be the ideal stage when a young entrepreneur should reach the VCs? Like, it's a chicken and egg problem. Most of the people suggest that you should have a basic prototype ready and then you should present your idea to the VC. But for making a basic prototype, you need people, you need developers, and you need to pay them. So again, for the funding, yeah, we need to approach them. It's a chicken and egg problem. So
we were just waiting for that question. So, Shailen, why don't you take it?
Yeah, this question almost comes I think every young entrepreneur starting out. Look, one key trait that VCs look for is resourcefulness. So, you know, assemble the resources. I think the Flipkart guy started with a few lakh rupees. That's not a lot of money. Under 10 lakh, I'm pretty sure. And that's not a lot of money. So, you know, you should be able to have the resourcefulness to pull in enough money from your friends and family so you can build a prototype. Even if capital is available, I would recommend you do that. It doesn't matter if somebody says, hey, I'll give you 20 lakhs or 50 lakhs, or a VC says, I'll give you $1 million. You will do yourself a great service if you force yourself to be resourceful early on and bootstrap yourself. So do that. And I think from a venture capitalist perspective, and Akash, you should chip in here, I think people are looking to understand, you know, see proof that you are thinking about building a big business and you have done the groundwork and homework, which could be a beta product, it could be market research, it could be customer surveys. You have done the homework to figure out what it will take to build a big business and how to differentiate yourself. And you have sort of set yourself on a roadmap to do that. That roadmap could involve having a few supplier relationships that are quite critical. There's no one magic rule that I can say, hey, if you have a beta product, you know, you should go look for capital. Instead, I would say, you know, as an entrepreneur, the common perception is that, you know, it's a very risky path and you take a lot of risk. I think a great entrepreneur is a great risk manager, because there is risk in a new company. So, you know, if you can think comprehensively about your business and create a roadmap to saying, you know, here's what I need to do in every aspect of the business that will help me you know, create an enduring enterprise and present that path, you know, you'll be surprised that investors will be willing to take to back you quite early, and even without, you know, having too much revenues or explicit traction per se.
If I may add, I think the way I look at it is the following. You know, I don't think entrepreneurs exist because VCs exist. It's the vice versa. VCs exist because entrepreneurs exist. You guys have taken the risk earlier than VCs ever took. Because once you have built the business, you have shown traction to whatever level it could be, that's when the external funding agency comes in. And therefore, I think it's not so much trying to figure out a way as a goalpost to when I'll raise my fund and that success. That's only by the way. That's what you do to actually take the company to the next orbit, which is why different types of, you know, call them funding agencies or partners exist in the market. There are angels, there are VCs, then there are private equity players. And as you keep growing from one stage of the business to the other, you'll meet different types of people. You know, for example, Sequoia is a VC. Now, does that mean that we, you know, you should knock a door of a VC or an angel when you have 10 customers, you know, 100 employees? Very hard to say. I think that choice has to be made at the time when you have built some, built very strong confidence and conviction in your business model that it works. And you have come to a level of maturity where now you want to take the business to a next orbit by partnering with an external partner. That's a very different mind shift. I think, you know, I'm trying to add the qualitative aspect to what, you know, Shailendra said. So there's no easy answer, but that's how you can think about it.
Hi,
hey.
Oh,
sorry, we had a gentleman over there. Thank you for the question. Anyone? Vijay, do you want to?
Yeah, let me first address your first question on mobile and whether that will leapfrog. I think for many years we have heard in India that mobile user base is much bigger than the internet user base, and that therefore you should see mobile leapfrogging, you know, regular internet in India. We think it's not easy for it to happen for two or three reasons. One, that a purchase decision is much a result of the consumer's experience online. And, you know, every entrepreneur, I'm sure, will agree that, you know, every little tab, every little, you know, choice you made on how to have them navigate, how you display the price, you know, how many images of the product you put, the videos that you add, you know, make a difference to the conversion funnel. So much of this for the mobile is not yet evolved enough, and at least as yet there isn't enough proof that a large enough percentage of people are buying. Now, if people disagree, you should jump in, but I think people are browsing, but the purchase itself is not happening on the mobile.
Actually, mobile is more used for services. Like, for example, if you place an order online through the web, and if you want to get updated on what's happening to your order, whether it's shipped or not, or what is the airway bill details of the logistics company, when is that going to get delivered to you? So the mobile aspect comes in the service level of the whole transaction lifecycle.
I think just to add to it, on the first one, I think, yes, mobile for e-commerce is taking its time, but I think what we have seen is with the investment that we have done on WAP and apps, that it's mature, it's growing up. I won't say it's as growing as fast as the e-commerce is, but it's definitely growing, and it has that potential 2 years down the line or 1 year down the line. And on your second part, though a very difficult one, I think soon we should have more technology involvement on the voice side, which will help, you know, address us address us, give us platforms to serve products and deliver conduct transactions over voice as an IVR, using IVR as a tool, rather than fully dependent on being web as a tool.
Yeah, so actually I want to address the second part of the question, especially from a technology perspective. There's a startup called ProLogic Software based in Lucknow. And what they've done is they've built a tool, a text-to-speech converter, which is designed for Indian languages and Indian accents. And they're the first of their kind to do that. And they've been in business for a little more than 3 years. The challenge they have faced is that the only entities interested in that kind of... So first of all, what the solution does is, any website, they just put a little JavaScript. And there's a backend server running, and that server reads out the entire website in an Indian accent in Hindi, and Indian accent in English and in Hindi. But the investment required to build a text-to-speech engine in other languages is substantial, of the order of 50-60 lakh rupees to build each engine. They invested upfront because they got some order from the government, because the government was very interested in doing some accessibility solutions. They reached out to various players in the market to help them grow. And everywhere the hurdle that they reached was, people did not see a market potential because of the total scale of audience that this would address. What has brought about a change now in perception, we know because we work very closely with them with some of the government programs. What we saw the change was, because a text-to-speech engine not only caters to the blind, it also actually caters to the uneducated. And with the likes of so many government programs like NREGA and all running, and there's so much pilfering of money that is to be handed out to them, because they can't read, they can't go online, they can't see how much entitlement they're due to, and there's a middleman who actually says, okay, you are owed 300 rupees, when the guy's actually owed 800 rupees for the work he did in the last month or so, whatever. So I think what would require more adoption would be interest from web based organization, whether it's e-commerce or other offerings, or very large players who have a web presence, to realize the potential that the market brings. Because in India, more than half the population is actually uneducated, especially we know web penetration is low on top of that. But technology does have an answer. I think the business has to catch up with it and be able to address that.
Thank you.
Yeah, I am Shailesh Gupta, and I have a question for Sachin. That Paytm has nicely So Paytm has nicely integrated discount coupons with mobile recharge, and I want to ask that I want to understand the economics behind this kind of model, having discount coupons. And second thing, what kind of social innovations you are looking forward to in your business?
Okay, answering the first one first regarding coupons, I think there are multiple dimensions to couponing as a business. Recharge as a business has seen a few companies taking couponing as a route to give a value add to the customer. Compared to any other e-commerce, we don't play on margins, so we cannot offer a 10% discount or a 20% discount. So how do we say that, how are we better than any other, a panwala shop or any other channel of buying a recharge? We give our customers an extra value, and it helps the whole ecosystem. So, there are a lot of e-commerce companies who are looking for customers who are e-commerce ready, or who are, who are doing transactions online. So platforms like us, which have very high traffic as well as high number of transactions, the e-commerce partners look at us as a medium to promote their service, and they have their discounting or couponing discounting systems in place, and they use our channel to promote their service to the customers who are doing transactions. There are also companies like Pizza Hut and Domino's of the world who look at this as a medium to connect with the youth, because for us, when you do look at mobile recharge, the customer segment would be 15 to 25 or 30, and when you look at DTH recharge, the customer segment would be 30 to 40. So it's a medium for them to connect with them and create a brand recall and again drive traffic onto their stores.
I think it's the question, I got the question right. It was the market is large, and even no questions about it, and not even questioning the sustainability of the couponing business model as such. Mm-hmm. But how does, in this low ticket size, the economics play out?
Was that your question?
So the economics is that there are some coupons which we offer, the most coupons that we offer free, and there's a redemption that is associated with each coupon, and you know that depends on what kind of value it is and what kind of value the partner is getting, and we get a redemption business out of it.
Okay.
And the second part was related to social.
I may suggest that in the interest of time, I think if this is a specific question to
we can take it one to one.
Let's go to another question.
Hi. I have a question for Shailendra. My name is Kunal. I'm an entrepreneur. It's not a funding-based question. So you have a lot of portfolio companies in India. I wanted to understand that, you know, given the way the e-commerce market is growing in India, so you have basically profitability versus delayed gratification, get more customers now, worry about profitability later. There's always a choice of positioning your product, like, you know, premium high margin product versus a low margin, forget profitability, we'll figure it out later kind of a decision. So in your portfolio companies, how are you seeing this decision being made? I'm planning to launch something which will potentially be e-commerce, hence the question.
Yeah, I think if I may rephrase, the question is about, do you make the trade-off to lower margins and acquire customers upfront with a view to acquiring them later, or do you aspire for profitability sooner? If I may also rephrase, you're specifically focused on the India market, correct? Yeah, I think it's really a no right answer, in short. Very largely, unfortunately, it's a function of what other people do, because there's game theory at play here. So if you want to be a profitable business and you compete with a guy who doesn't want to build a profitable business in the short term, then you're going to be massively disadvantaged. So this irrational competition that I mentioned during my session is because if one guy chooses to behave irrationally, other guys are forced to follow suit. You know, goes back to the whole telecom, you know, wars we saw last year with the per second billing. So fortunately or unfortunately, it's a market makeup, a current mindset, and the market is tilting towards saying acquire more customers and get to more scale, and we'll figure out the unit economics later. Now that's going to result in winner take all dynamics, because it's going to result in the last man standing phenomena, and the companies that are most well capitalized and can offer the steepest discounts and make the most losses but sustain them will basically be able to outspend other guys. Now, is that and which is why the focus of my talk was to say, you know, outthink them and don't try to do the same as they're doing. If they're discounting and you're also discounting, then, you know, you're at a disadvantage competing with a guy that has more capital. So you have to pick segments of the market where either there is less competition or a business model that gives you an advantage on margins or gives you an advantage in acquiring customers in a more innovative manner. And then you can compete with a gorilla. They may have more money to bleed, but you don't, you're not competing on their turf in entirety, or you found an innovative way to bypass an area they may be spending a ton of money in.
Anyone from this side? Yeah. The gentleman over here, the one who's standing? Yeah. So we'll take that and then we'll come to you. Thanks. So SKU catalog management, including prices, maybe Jitendra, you wanted to.
Yeah. So
we are in the process of launching something called Product Information Management Catalog, where we are trying to be the building the biggest catalog, which will have all the SKUs with the proper pricing and everything, which we are maybe in the very early stage right now, but we will be launching in 3 months' time, where we'll be tying up with manufacturers and getting the MRPs directly from them. MRP is a suggested price. So any of the large retailers also, MRP is a suggested price, inclusive of taxes. But there is, of course, a discount available, and you can play around that discount. So MRP is just to showcase a price for a customer and showcase a discount which you want to sell it. So, but you will be getting a catalog maybe in the next 3 months or 4 months' time, where we will be having a large SKUs, and which we'll be selling as a SaaS model to all the people who are interested.
Yeah, I guess Jitin, his question is more about groceries, which is a much
so grocery will category. Be also be part of that. So the branded groceries, and maybe when you are saying a groceries, all the packaged goods, say Kohinoor Basmati and all those guys, those will be the part of that catalog also.
I think there is no, the industry is being formed as we speak. So if you set a standard, let us know. I think few players in this market specifically. It's been a tough one. It's very early on, and you know, many people on the stage can sort of add to this. But I think we see probably 10 to 15 grocery companies overall, and few global comparables. If we just talk about the category, few that have become large, but it's been largely local business, meaning serving a particular region. So I don't think there is a particular, unfortunately, you know, a particular industry standard of being able to dynamically, with a low cost, refresh your price on an ongoing basis. Maybe you need to go to SKUs, which do not dynamically change over a day, but at least give you the window of about a fortnight or a month. Let's go
I
to
have
someone
a question.
Who
a question. Just excuse address that sorry. Quickly. From a technology perspective, there are a lot of solutions available to address that. But the question you have to ask is, can you afford them? And what is the scale at which you are going to be able to utilize them? On the flip side, this is a great opportunity to offer or build a technical solution. Okay. That can support a lot of new startups that need the same kind of offering, where you can do catalog management on the fly on a mobile or something, and it stores in a server, makes it available to your site.
I have Thank a you. Question.
Yeah, please. I think, again, you know, like many people answered, there will be no specific hard answer to this. Can I suggest that we move on to a little bit of a different bucket of questions if people had?
I have a question here. Excuse me. I have a question. Hello.
Yeah. you are one persistent person, so we like that. Please. very good one.
Let me try to help you. I think rather than try to think of building a business plan, try to think of how much you want to pay to acquire a customer and how much money you will make from that one customer and how many repeat transactions you need. If you had a business plan showing millions of dollars of marketing spend a month, chances are people will raise eyebrows. Do one thing at a time. You know, set your goal of saying, you know, I will try to get to 100-200 transactions a day in, you know, second, third month of launch, and then I will recalibrate to understand, you know, am I acquiring customers effectively enough or not? The rough math in the industry is it takes between 500 to 1,000 rupees, depending on the category you're in, to acquire a customer, roughly. And so you can work backwards from that, depending on how big a business you want to build, how quickly. Absolutely. I think
Shailen, should I suggest we take it offline? Just given that there are tons of follow-up questions on just marketing.
I have a question
Never ever forget the organic growth. That's very, very important. Like, that's very critical. And organic does not mean, I'm talking only about Google. You can build a fascinating Facebook app nobody has got. And that can send traffic to you. And that will be part of a company for a long, long time.
Great. Sorry. This is a question to...
The lady over here.
Yeah, thank you for asking that. It's at least something we would like to see more of as well. There are some attempts to launch marketplaces. I think Infibeam is in the process of doing that, and you know, the tools, etc., they are making available essentially allows them to become a marketplace. There are other attempts at that. We expect some of the larger e-commerce companies to also try to go in that direction, where once they have enough traffic, they're going to say, "Hey, come and you know, put up your shop on you know, my e-commerce website." So I think we'll see more and more of that. Marketplaces take a long time to incubate. So when the marketplaces in China were launched, at that point, you know, China e-commerce B2C was not hot, if you will. And China has a very interesting and maybe perhaps a little bit different supply chain infrastructure, where a lot of goods sold all over the world are made in China. So there are more manufacturers, more distributors of goods than there are in India. But your question is right. There should be more marketplace, you know. Correct. Correct. Yeah, so. Yeah, again, going back, right, marketplace is a better business model because it has network effects, it's more defensible, but it's tougher to get the network effects going. You need a large enough number of shops, and you need enough traffic. You need either the demand or the supply to be so strong that you can attract the other.
Can I just add?
Yeah, I think they have to go hand in hand. My sense is if you have demand, then it's easier to build supply because you'll always find people who want to sell through your channel.
Just to add to this, we just launched something called Marjack Exchange because we have an ample number of vendors who wants to sell through various channels. So we have created something called a Marjack Exchange. So there are many publishers who wants to use the entire vendor acquisition, what we have already have, and use their products to start a marketplace. We already are live with couple of, you can say, closed user group marketplaces where almost zero acquisition cost, where the vendors can offer a much better pricing and a transaction commission.
Just a quick show of hands. How many people have a C2C business model here? Direct consumer to consumer.
I have a question which I've been persisting for quite some time.
Go ahead.
So this is to Shailender. Fashion and You, as you mentioned, buys back to back, right? Of late, I've heard that they've raised $40 million. Can I understand what is this towards? They're not building logistics, they're not building inventory, but what is this funding towards?
They're actually exactly doing that. They are moving to a hybrid model of being able to deliver faster, so they are building inventory, and they are building local logistics. In the Delhi NCR region, they already deliver more than 80% of orders through own logistics and much faster than through courier companies. So, you know, earlier this question was asked, should you do consignment or inventory? And like I said, I think the market is moving towards inventory because all vendors are, all these e-commerce companies are going to compete with each other on quality of service. And, you know, the Indian consumer is not evolved enough to say, I will wait 2 weeks if you give me a great discount. They want the discount and they want it today.
But isn't it counterintuitive wherein Taobao has a marketplace which is anti-invent, which is no inventory?
You could say so, but the number of SKUs you can assemble, if you remember the Taobao example, 800 million items. So the true long tail effect, it is arguably impossible to do that as a direct B2C company unless you grow very, very, very large. So as you're starting out, you will have the big benefit of having a very large number of long tail SKUs, And I have some personal experiences in India where I've tried to, you know, shop for things and not found them anywhere, but found them on eBay because it's a marketplace. So that's the big benefit.
Thanks.
Okay. Gentleman over here. Right. I think given this is a specific question to your business model, you know, happy to chat with you, you know, more detailed in terms of how it works. Yeah. Well, you know, at the very high level, what we've felt is that customization per se is difficult to scale. But I think we may be missing something here. So, yep. You know, happy to chat with you in more detail.
I'll take this quickly. I mean, we have been offering customization at CBazaar. I mean, we have been selling this from 2005, the day when we launched CBazaar. So customization, sometimes it depends on what product you're selling and which market you're addressing to. See, when we're selling in India, we don't find customization, it's a very important thing for our consumers to buy from us. But when we're selling overseas, customization becomes a very important thing. So it depends to which market you're selling. But if customization is required for your business, then you have to do it.
But you know, follow-on question there. So, of the total gross merchandise value that you sell, mm-hmm. how much is customized versus how much is standard SKU?
I mean, we for us it evolved actually. You know, we started with 10% of our products customized, and it just grew up from that. So it depends on how you are positioning your product to the consumers. If you want to just sell ready-made products and not non-customized, you still have a market for that. So it depends on your capacity, what exactly you want to do.
Hi, this is Nandan here. I think we have people from very diverse background in the panel. So if we could have a first top of your mind, how would you make your e-commerce campaign go viral from each one of you?
All right. Now, I think maybe last two questions. Yeah? Just because we're...
Yeah.
Go ahead. I think given you answered too much already. What's the question?
You guys are not serious. Most of you are not serious about any building social media strategy. Is that the case, or you guys are building up the team? And is there any social media strategy in place, or if you have an in-house team for social media?
I think Sachin did answer a little bit about what he was doing with social. I would think most people would decline that they're not serious. They are serious. And Shraddha is, you know, waving, saying the time is up. All right. Awesome. So one last question from the gentleman over there.
This is to Mr. Rajesh.
I think the guy who has the mic has the power. So,
so this is like, what are the major challenges an Indian e-commerce company faces when he is catering to other countries, like, you know, globally when he is doing that? And also another question for Shailendra is that you have compared the China model to the India, but I think the language is also a major pull in China, I guess, because if you see Google and Baidu, I think India, every Indian searches online through Google, but whereas in China they do it through Baidu and all that. So
could you show, put some light on this thing?
So your first question was basically, what are the challenges in selling abroad versus in India? Okay. I mean, in our case, we first started selling in India when we launched Chennai Bazaar. We did COD and all that in late 98, 99 and 2000. And then we moved on to the, because we were quite early for the Indian market, those days the adoption was very less. And then we moved on to the diaspora market, basically. Again, they're Indians, but overseas Indians. So, we had certain challenges those days, but right now I don't think there's any big challenge for any Indian company to sell abroad. In fact, it's better. I mean, it's easier in some ways. Of course, you have to make sure that your payment gateways are in place. Your compliance is there. I mean, legal, statutory compliance are all in place. Other than that, I think selling abroad is not a big challenge. And I feel there is more challenge in selling in India. We have recently launched in India, and logistics has been one of the challenge. Another perspective, see, in cbazaar.com, we sell more than 15,000 SKUs, 15,000 Indian ethnic apparel, whereas in cbazaar.in, we sell only 8,000, 9,000 apparels. The reason why is that is because in India, we have realized that, as Shailendra mentioned, people want, the moment they place an order, they want the product to be delivered within 24 hours or 48 hours. So the expectation starts building up right from the time they see the product online. Whereas customers overseas, they are used to waiting for 2 weeks, 3 weeks. So that you're addressing two different sets of customers, and you have to build your business accordingly.
Yeah, on the question of China versus India and the language differences, you're totally right. The language differences make it harder for global companies to compete in China. However, e-commerce is a very local business. So what you saw in travel, which is that the domestic companies did well, we think similarly in e-commerce, because it's hyper-local, logistics intensive, involves the movement of physical goods, we will see local companies do well. But because of the language differences, the international guys like Amazon have an advantage in India, which they didn't have in China. So we will see an eBay and an Amazon be relatively more powerful in India than they are in China, is our best guess. So,
just to add, like last week I saw a shop which was selling Marathi tag T-shirts on our platform, and they just innovated. We didn't know it was possible; they just did it. So,
right. Well, with that, we'll sort of end the session, but really not end it, in the sense that there were hopefully some questions which got answered, and hopefully, fortunately, still there were many more which have come to your mind now. So we'll all be around here, floating around. Please keep asking as insightful questions. It was lovely to be here with you. I thank all the panelists here for spending the time. Thank you so much.